You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Now, one of the things about history, when we take a look at history and we take a look at the past, we use a tool, historians, is known as periodization. And so history and periodization is very important. It is a tool that we use to measure change over time. And this is what historians are involved in, measuring change over time. So, like, for instance, in this particular class, we're going to take a look at the past, and we're going to try to see how that past is influencing the present today. And so what we do is we break the past down into meaningful chunks to measure change over time. Because what historians do is they're looking and analyzing a change. They're trying to understand what changed and what was continuous. So continuity and change over time. So we use the term periodization, so we break down the past into meaningful chunks so that we break the past down into places so that we can understand. Like, for instance, if I were just to throw out a date, 1492, all of you automatically would think of what happened before and what happened after, because 1492 is the year that Columbus arrives in the Western Hemisphere. So that's, you know, that's a benchmark date. We use that. 1776, there's a benchmark date there that year, July 4th. That's a benchmark date that helps us to understand change over time. What happened previously, what happened after. So we're constantly using that in history, okay? So one of the things that I've created with regards to understanding change over time is that most often we put all the information in history, puts it in a linear. You know, you always see a linear experience with regards to history as it goes from simple societies to complex societies. You know, we can start with the hunting and gathering societies, and then the rise of civilizations, and then, you know, the complex societies that we have today with regards to the development of the scientific, the development of the productive forces in science as we move from steel to aluminum to plastics to computer chips, and we all put them on a continuum. You know, we got 1492, 1776, the 19th century, the 20th century, 1910, 1920, the 1950s, the 1960s. And supposedly, you know, we're over here in 2018 and everybody else was back there. So we kind of take a look in terms of linear. There's the linear experience, and it kind of gives us an idea that we're more superior to people who are over there, because after all, look at what we're living in with the new technology that we have. You know, we have push-button civilization that we have today, and we're always taking a look at, oh, look how primitive those people lived in the past. That's our linear experience. The linear experience kind of tends to give us the notion that we're more superior to societies that lived before us. I take what is known as a cyclical approach, okay? I take a cyclical approach because we live in cycles. We're not any more superior than the people who lived 20,000 years ago, because the people who lived 20,000 years ago can deal with the climate change that's going to happen to us, because we're not going to be able to survive climate change because we don't know how to go onto the earth and identify the plants and the animals that are going to help us survive this catastrophe. But people back then, they had a really nice understanding of the respect for the earth and a knowledge, an ethnobotanical knowledge that allowed them to survive off the earth and what the earth had to offer. So we're really not as superior as those ancient populations are. We just are more dependent on technology. And technology has divorced us from the elements. So I take a cyclical approach because most often what happens is that everybody says, well, history repeats itself, or you're doomed to repeat history. No, what we do is we live in cycles. We live in cycles. So in these cycles, we have different patterns that we follow from the past, okay? Because we're all human beings, all right? And we do the same things as all human beings have done throughout entire history. So I believe in a cyclical approach, okay? And so in this sense, when we take a look at the Chicano identities, we want to take a look at what Chicano means, okay? And this is where I'm going to share with you the different Chicano identities, and I'm going to take a cyclical approach. And in this particular case, I'm going to periodize the past in a circle rather than a line, Okay? So if we can get this chart here, and I want to share with you something about the different identities. Because one of the things that is most important, and this is where I fit in, I want to share with you my understanding of my identity as a Native person. So let's take a look at this particular chart, and you'll understand something about the cyclical approach. Now, I'm from the border. I am from El Paso, Texas. And so I'm using, as you take a look at the southwest United States and northern Mexico, because I was born and raised in Isleta, which is a Native American community just southeast of downtown El Paso. So I'm from Isleta, Texas, okay? So I'm going to use this so we can understand what we're going to be doing in terms of our approach. If you could take a look at here, this is what I call the full circle theory, and you'll see that the hoop is broken. And this is the notion of the Chicano experience, that the hoop is broken. And I want you to understand, from Indians to Chicanos, Diego Vigil has it right. Okay? So here is 1492. So everything that becomes before is that indigenous identity. This is the root of the Chicano experience, is the Native identity. So when we take a look at the historical experiences of Chicanos, all the way to 1492, that is our Native past. Now, many times I'm always asked by some of my friends who are high school teachers and grade school teachers to come in and talk to their students and share with them something with regards to identities, because everybody says, well, are we Mexican, or are we American, or are we Hispanic, or are we Chicano, or what are we? So I share with them this particular experience. This chart is a periodized chart. It's my full circle theory. If we understand our identities, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then a return. A cyclical. Life is cyclical. So our life has been in a cycle. We start with our indigenous identities prior to the arrival of Europe. And so when we take a look at the indigenous identities, we understand certain things about the rich history that was here prior to Columbus. And that rich history starts with the archaic peoples, and then eventually the rise of agriculture, known as the what anthropologists call the pre-classic period in Mesoamerica, Middle America, and then in the indigenous cultures that flourished in the classic period from central Mexico into the Mississippi and down to South America, to the classic period with the rise of the Mexica. So there is a Native identity that's very important, because we as Chicanos, we're part of it. We have it in our blood. As you shared, the red beans, these are the red beans. Then when the red beans, their history goes 1492, Columbus arrived, so the white beans arrived. And the white beans brought black beans with them from Africa. So the white beans and the black beans arrived, and then they also are going to recruit yellow beans from Asia. Well, I'll be talking about that in this class. So the indigenous, the red beans, are going to encounter what is known as the Hispanic period, or the Spanish colonial era, between 1492 to this year, 1821. In this period, everybody, the most important identity that was emphasized was the Hispanic, to the detriment of the indigenous. All indigenous memories are going to be wiped out for a Spanish colonial past. So the colonial settler societies are going to be very important. And in this period, there's going to be three major institutions that are going to be introduced that we're going to be dealing with in this class. And that is the mission, the presidio, and the pueblo. The rise of the mission, the mission system, the transforming peoples from Native peoples into Spanish-speaking workers. And we're going to appreciate that in Chicano Studies 100. The Spanish colonial period emphasized things Hispanic. But what's going to happen with regards to the racialization, and the racialization process is going to be introduced, where Native peoples, Africans, and Asians are going to be excluded to the and those who are going to be in an advantageous position, are going to be those who can prove their birthright to Europe. So Hispanic becomes important. There is a Hispanic identity, a Hispano identity, that's going to be shaped in this period between 1492. Now, in 1810, I should have put 1810, but by 1821, a new constitution is going to be written where Mexico Mexica. This term Mexica is going to come from the indigenous experience. Mexica is going to become the new identity. It's going to be known as Mexicano. And this is the Mexican national period. It will begin in 1821 with the creation of a separate Mexico. But by 1824, a constitution is going to be written, a liberal constitution creating the nation of Mexico. So a new identity is going to be forged based on an appreciation of the indigenous identity and no longer referencing Hispanic. In fact, Mexicano refuses, in fact, the liberation that occurred here in this experience to create the Mexicano is to downgrade the Hispanic. They call them the Gachupin. No longer are Mexicans to identify as Hispanic. They are now Mexica, Mexicanos, back to the indigenous. But something curious is going to happen here in the southwest United States of northern Mexico that's going to transform this identity, because the United States is going to have a war with Mexico, create a war with Mexico, and within 2 years, take over half of what Mexico is. And so the identity is going to change once the United States comes in to occupy the other half of Mexico. So a new identity is going to be created by 1920, because Americans are going to take a look at the Mexican experience and they're going to say, well, are you Mexican or are you American? And so the Mexican-American experience is going to come about as a result of the U.S. occupation. So as you're going to be reading Vigil talks about the six C's in culture, the three C's, the first three C's, the second three C's, and then establishment and toleration. So there's class, culture, and color, and then contact, conflict, and change. Class, culture, color, contact, conflict, and change. But I'm going to share with you the racialization process and the four-part process of change. So there's a Mexican-American experience that's going to go all the way from 1848 to 1960. And what's going to be unique about this experience is that by World War II, a lot of Mexicans are going to join World War II, and they're going to go fight against fascism. When they come back, they're going to have to face the racialization process. And in that process, Mexican-American comes into acceptance for the population. But it never addressed the racialization process. It never addressed identity, so that by 1960, there's a civil rights movement and Chicano comes into existence. Now, Chicano, the understanding of what Chicano means is to resist the racialization process. Chicano means that you appreciate the identity that came out of the struggle of being in a disadvantaged position, of being in an isolated position, of having to deal with the prejudices. In fact, Chicano was a term that was used in this era to identify lowlife, to identify working class peoples who the upper classes looked at as with disdain. So Chicano was a derogatory term to identify people who had no culture. And so Chicano was a cultural renaissance to tell everybody, you know what, we appreciate who we are. We understand the four-part process, and we want to address civil rights. We want to make sure that we are involved in getting rid of social racial discrimination, in making sure we have access to education to stop the deprivation, in making sure that we join unions so that we have economic rights so we don't have to live in poverty and economic marginality, and most important, to change the political system to help us understand who we are. Okay? So there's been different identities as we go full circle. Now, Chicano meant to also go back to the native roots. And that's what I represent as part of the Chicano movement, is that I'm going back and understanding a native past that has been wiped out from us since then. And this is what the Chicano movement is all about, bridging that gap, making this circle complete again, as we saw in what Felicia Fe Montes is attempting to do with Mujeres de Maíz. She's moving back to the indigenous connection. And that's what the Chicano movement is all about, making this circle again to start all over again, going back to our traditional roots, which is in the land. This is so important. So we have many identities. We have an indigenous identity, we have a Hispanic identity, we have a Mexican identity, a Mexican-American identity, and a Chicano identity. But the identities, we can eventually, once we move back to indigenous native, we can recognize that. But in 1975, there was a reaction by the elite classes, a reaction by the dominant society to Chicano. And so they began to emphasize that they want Mexicans to become Hispanic. Because after all, Mexicans are deported, not Hispanics. So the idea was to go back to the Spanish past. And when you go back to the Spanish past, you deny the historical struggle of coming to Chicano. So to identify yourself as Hispanic is to demean the history of this experience. And this was done on purpose. So you need to recognize that if you are a Mexicana, if you are a Chicana, if you are a Chicano, if you are Mexican, to identify yourself as Hispanic is what the larger society wants you to do because it emphasizes Europe and it emphasizes that experience. So really what the Chicano means is going back to your indigenous roots because we are part of it. Now, one of the things that's unique about this circle is that if you see right here, up until about this point, this is what Chicano Studies 100 is all about. So when you take Chicano Studies 100, we're going to be involved in this course all the way to right after the war, the U.S. occupation. Chicano Studies 200 is about this experience here, and then Chicano Studies 300 takes a look at the literature. So welcome to Chicano Studies 100, and this is the periodization and recognize all the different identities. Now let's conclude this segment by going and understanding and appreciating the native peoples that live along the U.S.-Mexico border because they're on both sides and they can help us appreciate something about Chicano.
Personally, I cringe every time I hear the word illegal.
I don't think that...